Hey, hi, howdy, and salutations. This is possibly the start of some weird content on this channel. Just as I was figuring out that I wanted to make some short films and really express my creative side, this stuff hit. So now that I'm at home, and you guys are also probably at home, I figured we should try to get to know each other before I start telling you random stuff about movies. So, hi, my name is Renee. I really, really like movies. I eventually want to be a film director one day, and I want to be a showrunner at some point as well, but that's another topic for another day. So I thought today we could look at some of my top 10 favorite movies, because I say it's a good idea, and who's gonna stop me? Have you ever seen a movie that grips you for some reason, but you can't quite figure it out? This movie was the first one like that for me. It's a movie that is about the mundane, but is so wonderful and has a great directorial style to it that it just pulls you in. And I think it's a really well done movie all around. I think critics were definitely too critical of it when it first came out, and a good chunk of people who see it will end up liking it. Ben Stiller, Kristen Wiig, and Sean Penn give great performances. The cinematography is very, 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 very nice. And the music is absolutely stunning, with original track from Jose Gonzalez. It also introduced me to my favorite band of all time, of Monsters and Men, which, by the way, their album Beneath the Skin is the best album of the 21st century. I will hear no arguments against it. This movie can be rough around the edges at times, but if you give it a chance, it can be an inspirational thing to watch. A frequent complaint I hear about Up is that it can never live up to its opening, which I think is a weird claim to make. The beginning is iconic and a great example of storytelling without words, but it's just that, a beginning. What makes Up special is it's a funny, colorful, unique movie about grief and how to let go. Russell makes for a great foil for Carl, Doug is absolutely adorable, and I love any movie that takes a pot shot at Charles Lindbergh. Seriously, the man was a scumbag. I could make an entire video about how I think this has some of the best messaging from Pixar, but for now, I'll just say, give it another shot. It's a thoroughly good movie, and maybe you'll change your opinion on it. Okay, so maybe having a Marvel movie on here kills some of my credibility, but hear me out. Guardians is a really good movie. In fact, I think it's phenomenal. From the second scene onward, it pushed Marvel in a new direction and had a hand in influencing the entire superhero genre for the foreseeable future, making it weirder, wackier, and more like its comic roots. This is also on here for being representative of some of Marvel stuff. Some stuff from other Marvel movies are just some of my favorite things to watch, from action sequences to emotional sequences, but I don't feel like those movies belong on this list. But that doesn't take away from how funny, colorful, and emotional this entire movie is. This is a really fun movie to watch, too. I don't like rewatching movies often, but I have at least watched this movie 6 times. Quill is a likable protagonist, and the group dynamic is great. That being said, the highs in Volume 2 are much higher than this movie. It's funnier, more heartbreaking at times, and I love the soundtrack that much more. I mean, it's not even fair to compare the two soundtracks. But this movie's always going to be the better one, because I think there's a certain charm to this one that the second one didn't have. Not that it's bad, but I wouldn't think that these two movies are equal. They're just very different. This movie does have weaknesses. The fact that Ronan's about as rich and meaningful as a piece of rotten cardboard, and at times this movie can feel a little too generic. But again, it's a unique movie for the majority of its runtime, so it can't be upset when it stumbles.
Theme song guy.
This is the best Disney movie of all time. You can't tell me that I'm wrong. It has it all. Talking animals, a musical number, great voice acting, an iconic Disney villain, and henchmen, and so many memorable jokes. This movie is, in one of my opinion, the funniest animated movies ever, one of the most quotable movies ever. I cannot tell you how much my sense of humor has been influenced by this movie. David Spade nails his performance as Kuzco, making him a lovable, spoiled jerk, and also one of the best Disney princes. John Goodman also does a great job of Pacha, to the point where I actually forgot it was him, because John Goodman's just a really good voice actor. I mean, just every voice role he does is iconic. And what can I say about Patrick Warburton that already hasn't been said? Kronk is an icon. That being said, Yzma, I think is just the best antagonist in all of film. Seriously. Only one other film has a serious antagonist, and he doesn't even come close to Yzma. From the brilliant portrayal by Eartha Kitt, to the expressive animation she has, to the perfect quotes.
A llama? He's supposed to be dead!
Yeah, weird.
Yzma is by far my favorite character in this movie, and just in any Disney movie in general. This movie is great to watch when you need a laugh, and just for a little bit of fun, research Kingdom of the Sun. It's what this movie was originally supposed to be, the even musical number for Yzma, which, to no one's surprise, is just better than any Disney villain song. Some people may be haunted by the end of Midsummer, or maybe Pennywise is in their dreams. But the scene where Lady Bird is in New York will forever be burned into my brain, and I am damned to relive it every time I close my eyes. God damn it, Greta Gerwig. That being said, I relate to this movie in many ways, and it kind of feels like a direct attack at times, and not just because I really, really, really wanted to go to NYU. The direction in this movie is great. Gerwig manages to get so many good performances, and this is her debut movie, and this is her directorial debut. I have no other choice but to stand. Every performance in this movie goes from funny to heartbreaking, and it happens flawlessly. The writing's immaculate, and I recommend it to any teenager because I think it's a great coming-of-age movie. Look at me. I like cool film kid movies. Okay, but can I actually talk about this movie? This movie is very beautiful, very slow, and very methodical. It's like watching a painting come together in real time. The environment and world of this movie is so well built, I find myself wishing I could go back there. The best way I can describe this movie is that it paints with absent space, and by that I mean even if a moment isn't significant, it still helps make the broader movie that much stronger. This movie also knows how to play with your emotions like it's an exact science. When it wants you to feel sad, it will make you feel sad, and Sufjan Stevens' music will play. When it wants you to feel happy, it will play Sufjan Stevens to make you happy. It is incredible how well this movie can calculate for emotions. And it also has the weird feeling of making me feel like I've experienced months in the span of 2 hours. This movie also has a great showcase of performances from Hammer, Chalamet, and Strulbarg, each having their own highlights in their performances, though obviously Chalamet was the star and gave what I think was the strongest and best performance in this movie. The writing is always out of 10, and yes, there is the peach scene, but I counter that with the final scene, which will always just give me chills just by thinking about it. So I talked about Call Me By Your Name being a very comfortable movie to watch, and what's the opposite of that? This movie is very laid back, but I do not find myself comfortable watching it. If Call Me By Your Name invited you into its world, this movie does the exact opposite. The way Coppola makes Japan feel alien and isolating is a pitch-perfect depiction of loneliness. This is a very emotional movie, perhaps because it deals with loneliness in such a real and honest way. Halfway through this movie, tears just started falling out of my eyes, and I didn't even feel sad. That's just what this movie did. That's the power of Sofia Coppola. And you can't have this movie without the great performance that Bill Murray gives, but Scarlett Johansson gives a tour de force performance in this movie, and that's not even considering the fact she was 17 while she filmed this. Imagine a high school theater kid tried to give this performance. It's unfucking imaginable. Seriously, this is a great movie to watch, but if you are feeling sad in the littlest bit, this movie will fucking destroy you. Have you ever gotten 3 minutes into a movie and gone, oh no, I'm in love with a movie? Because I did with this movie, and I shit you not, it's the reason why I have to watch new movies all in one go. I just get so pumped up sometimes that I have to stop watching for 20 minutes. This is a very charming movie, and it draws you in on purpose. You're supposed to be enamored by the hijinks of Ferris and all of his charm, and I think it's a very interesting way to endear an audience to a movie. Seriously, Ferris is one of the most charismatic leads in film, and I think that makes the movie that much better. It's funny, memorable, and very unique to have fourth wall breaks in this genre, and I love when fourth wall breaks are done well. also the chase scene, which is so unbelievably stupid that I love it with all my heart. This movie is just one big Phineas and Ferb episode, and you can't tell me otherwise. John Hughes was a master of coming-of-age movies, and I still think this is the gold standard of the genre that only one movie has come close to. I will say, however, Slow Ann has the depth of a shallow end of a kiddie pool, and I think that's the only thing that has a major drawback in this movie. So every film kid has that one movie they just won't shut up about. For some, it's Pulp Fiction, Fight Club, Grand Budapest Hotel, Whiplash, La La Land. But for me, it's... This might be the most perfect movie to ever exist. I'm not kidding. Every aspect of this movie is so well done, I'm actually going to make a separate video about it at some point. This is a very good movie. It currently has 100% on Rotten Tomatoes with well over 200 reviews, and yes, I know how Rotten Tomatoes works, but that still meant everybody at least had a positive outlook on it. The first Paddington was already a beautiful and wholesome movie that was near perfect, and this movie fixed all what three flaws that first one might have had. For starters, the animation for Paddington is consistently good throughout the movie, and that's rare for a movie to have, even Marvel movies. Actually, especially Marvel movies.
What? It's just an ordinary crabby. Oh my goodness!
Also in this movie is Hugh Grant as the villain in what I can only describe as Oscar-worthy performance. It's truly marvelous in every way. He embraces the camp of the role, and that makes his performance so enjoyable to watch. I have a smile every time I watch that performance. It is... the best in that movie. Paul King also does a phenomenal job as a director, using his style to make the movie endearing to the audience and just beautiful to look at. The boat scene being the highlight of his creativity in the movie. The best way I could describe his style for the Paddington movies would be a faux Wes Anderson, which isn't a diss to Wes Anderson at all. King manages to use a style similar to Wes, but he almost makes it more fantasy-like rather than surreal. If surreal is the word you could use to describe Wes Anderson, it's also a family movie that appeals to everybody. It doesn't talk down to kids and it doesn't bore adults. The jokes are top-notch, and I still laughed at a few of them while I was editing this video. It's heartfelt, wholesome, beautiful, and has that certain British charm to it that I can't place. I can't think of any complaints for this movie. None. I recommend this movie to everybody. It doesn't matter if you've seen the first one or not, it might help a little, but this movie still works in its own. And I will never stop talking about this damn bear until the day I die. Paul King, please release Paddington 3 already. No one cares about your Willy Wonka movie. What we need is we need more Paddington. Hashtag give us the British bear. Honorable mentions. Movies that I like, but were either too similar to movies on this list, or movies that are just barely not perfect enough for my standards. The Princess Bride. Yes, I already talked about quotable movies with great jokes, but I have a dog named Buttercup. Everything I love about this movie, The Emperor's New Groove does better except for the romance. The romance is especially heartwarming in this movie. One of the best in film in general. Batman Returns. I love Tim Burton's directorial style, and I will always have a soft spot for him because I love comic accurate Batman stuff. Seriously, I want a long Halloween movie. But most importantly, this movie has three top tier actors: Beetlejuice, Frank Reynolds, and Miss Baltimore Krabs herself. La La Land. It's rare to see a tight-knit relationship between movies and music, so when Damien Chazelle does it so well, it's amazing to see. Also, it hurts like a motherfucker to rewatch. Anything by Ryan Johnson. Seriously, everything this man does is gold and I will not hear any slander. Brick, golden. Looper, absolute gold. The Last Jedi, even more gold. Knives Out, a masterpiece. Though I do need to see the Brothers Bloom. Sicario. The Juarez scene might be the most tension I've ever felt during a movie, and I've seen Midsommar and Hereditary. Denis Villeneuve owns my soul and I'm pretty sure he knows that. Blade Runner 2049. Another masterpiece by Denis Villeneuve. A great sci-fi movie with an eerie score and phenomenal visuals. If you like Sicario, you'll like this. What I said about other movies on this list can almost certainly apply to this movie in tenfold. I absolutely adore this movie on every level. I'm gonna try and avoid spoilers for this movie because it's something that is so incredible to watch. when you don't have any spoilers. Performance-wise, Amy Adams in this movie is Oscar-worthy, and I'd argue she's better than any winning performance in the 2010s. What she does in this movie is so incredibly difficult, but worth it for the rewatches, and it made her my favorite actress of all time. Hashtag an Oscar for Amy. This movie is also based on the short story, The Story of Your Life by Ted Chiang, which is a great read if you're a diehard sci-fi, but this movie expands on the story and I'd argue makes it better. It doesn't deviate too much, and it's a perfect example of what a good adaptation should be. Keep the spirit of the source material while making necessary changes in order for the medium to work. The visuals are absolutely stunning due to the breathtaking cinematography done by Bradford Young, which for the longest time I actually thought was done by Roger Deakins because of how gorgeous it looked, and also his other collaborations with Denis Villeneuve. The eerie score by Johan Johansson and the use of On the Nature of Daylight by Max Richter, the visual effects, and just everything in this movie stand to perfection and absolute wow due to Denis Villeneuve. Some of Villeneuve's other movies were mentioned as honorable mentions for a very good reason. The man knows how to get tension out of you, but also keep a story grounded. Even in a story where you have alien tentacle monsters who communicate via circles, the choices he makes in this movie are absolutely fantastic, and as great as the writing is, I don't know if this movie would be great without him at the helm. From his decision to keep the heptapods off screen for the first 20 minutes of the movie to let the tension and anticipation build, to how he does that final scene, he knows how to get a good performance out of his actors and always, always, always has fantastic cinematography. The man is the best working director out there and I cannot wait for Dune. By the way, please see this movie, it's worth every second to see. But those were some of my favorite movies. And some of them might get their own videos. But for now, I'm gonna leave you with that next week. It's gonna be weird, and I can't wait to show you guys what I'm thinking of. Till then, bye.